The reason that I choose Dionysius Monastery, first, it's a cenobitic type of a monastery where everything is in common. They don't have this is mine and that is yours. We eat together. The monastery takes care of us. And they give us our clothes or doctors or medicine. And we don't have to worry about our health. We don't have to worry financially about our clothes. They must take care of us. The only thing we do is work, do our share of the work for the monastery. My job here is to be a doorkeeper, a gatekeeper. Anyone that comes here, I'm supposed to ask them where they come from, how long are they going to stay, whether they had eaten, and how many are in their bunks, and things like that that a doorkeeper should ask. Then I admit them into the monastery. We'll go upstairs to the visitor room, which we call our fundari. There, I get them acquainted with the father that will take care of them. And the father that takes care of them will write their names and their occupation and all necessary information about the visitor.
Neighbor who's always ready to lend a helping hand. We help when disaster strikes, during fires, floods, hurricanes, and tornadoes. We help with food, clothing, health care, and a place to stay. We help when folks need blood. We help the elderly. We help expectant parents prepare for their baby. We help veterans get their benefits. We'll teach you how to check blood pressure. We'll teach you CPR, swimming, and first aid. We'll help you learn how to take better care of yourself and your family. We're the American Red Cross. People helping people. Everyone working together to improve things in your community. That's what Red Cross exists for. Join Red Cross. We'll help. Will you?
Hospitality, a Greek tradition, is swift and generous on Mount Athos. However, the monks have become extremely cautious in recent years, and a thorough inspection of every visitor's permit or the amonitiria is routine. Increasing theft of Byzantine treasures is an unfortunate fact. Before a visitor is allowed here, he must be screened through the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Athens, and at the ports of entry, Hierissos and Uranopolis. At the infirmary, Father Iakovos is justifiably proud of the empty beds, testimony both to the excellent care given the monks and to the healthfulness of the simple and rugged lives they lead. At Dionysiou Monastery, another of the familiar stone towers which served as lookout posts. Countless generations of monks have used them to scan the horizon for any sign of approaching hostile forces. Largely unused in recent years and badly abused by centuries of wind and weather, many of these deteriorating tower balconies have toppled into the sea. Father Simeon, a monk from Thessaloniki, is the monastery librarian. The library holds some 5,000 books and 900 manuscripts, most of them handwritten on parchment, the oldest of which date from the 7th century.
The miniatures, which are illustrations inside the manuscripts, and whose importance is not only obvious for the history of Christian art, but is also great for an attempt to understand the text, which are illustrated through the miniatures which are next, because the artist who made this miniature was always concerned to put it next to a text and give his own explanation.
On Dionysius' charter, St. John the Baptist stands between the monastery's founders, Byzantine Emperor Alexios Komnenos III of Trebizond and his wife Theodora. The signatures are inscribed at the bottom. Many of the parchment documents are chrysobules, or deeds and decrees from Christian royalty which donated land to the monastery. Monks are summoned to church services three times daily in a series of three signals. First, bells indicate a service will soon begin. Five minutes later, a wooden simandron proclaims the service is about to begin. And finally, the beating of an iron simandron and more bells warns that the service is beginning. At Dionysiou Monastery, its main church, or Katholikon, is dedicated to St. John the Baptist. Its architecture is a combination of Byzantine and Gothic. The miraculous icon of the Salutation of Mary, its face made of gum wax, again blackened by centuries of candle smoke, believed to be the work of the evangelist Luke. Many healing miracles are attributed to this icon, and a variety of gifts and mementos were donated, symbols of thanksgiving from those healed. The grace and beauty of Byzantine frescoes are an everyday sight to the monks of Mount Athos. They provide an opulent echo of the elegant art that was the art of Byzantium. Father Theodoros displays some of the monastery's relics. Among the most precious, the remains of Niphon, Archbishop of Constantinople, who resigned his throne to become a monk at Dionysiou. A crucifix which, the monks say, contains a piece of the original Holy Cross on which Christ was crucified. Another important monastery building, the refectory or dining hall. These wall frescoes attributed to the Cretan school date to the 15th century and depict various scenes from the New Testament. The refectory is decorated with themes from the Book of Revelation. As the monks take their meager meals beneath the ornate frescoes, one of their members perched on a high stool reads portions of the scripture. This wall mural represents the ladder of perfection of St. John Climacos. It illustrates the heights to which a monk may ascend through virtue and the endless struggle against hardship and temptation during the journey from earth to heaven. It is a symbol of monastic life, which constantly strives to purify passions, energies, and the faculties of human nature, dedicating them to union with God, despite attacks by demons and the devil. A sense of spiritual community is immediately evident among the monks of Mount Athos. While they consistently observe a meticulous respect for each other's privacy, they are swift to give assistance to a brother monk in need, whether the problem is spiritual or physical. At the end of each meal, traditional respect is paid to the monastery abbot by kissing his hand.